Welcome back. I've really been enjoying bananas recently. So I'd share that. Had a nice banana on the way in. I think potassium's good. 95% back. Still got a little bit of a cough. So we've done some interesting stuff. Apologies that the last 2 weeks I've just been really hammered, but I'm glad we've had people to help fill in. And I don't know, maybe you enjoy having a class that's not quite fifth gear, more third gear. How's everything going for everyone? How many people feel like, let me see a show of hands, still struggling with the, wrestling with the concepts, like don't quite have my head, your head around it, raise your hand. Okay, cool. And how many people feel like, oh, this is pretty cool. I've got a pretty solid grasp of how I could do templates and then how I could serve it and set up a Linux machine and get that deployed and, you know, serve the CSS and the images and the HTML and do my request routing. So different URLs bring back different files. How many people feel like, yeah, I've got that? So three hands, four hands, five hands. Okay, because that makes a determination about where we spend our time. So I should be able to start picking up speed a little bit as my health comes back. I was up this morning at 2:30, went to bed at 10, just couldn't sleep. So got up at 3:30 and then just started coding and did a bunch of air stuff. So I'm adding into the GoLang training on Udemy. Some how to do air handling in Go. So I recorded a bunch of those videos. And then put together some more challenges for today. So one of the, we looked at JSON, and we'll be coming back to JSON. So that's kind of like exposure, and then, you know, the more you expose yourself to something, the more it sticks. So we'll have another exposure to JSON in a bit. We did some JSON stuff, and then we also did that thing where you're passing data to templates, right, and figuring out what's the data structure we use. And so one of the, I think that we looked at this one in class, and multiple years of classes and have those multiple years displayed. Do you remember this one? So this was the data structure right here. How many people look at that and that's makes sense? Cool. All right. So how many people look at this and it's still a little bit like, whoa? Nobody? Excellent. So let's try one of these. So create a data structure to pass the template, which contains information about California hotels, including name, address, city, zip, and region. And region can be southern, central, northern, and it can hold an unlimited number of hotels. How do you create that data structure? So go ahead and at the either in your editor or GoLang Playground, create this data structure to store this data, which we would then pass as one piece of data to our template. So that was my first take. Pretty similar to what we just drew out on the board. And then to populate it, I've got hotels, which is a slice of hotel. So composite literal, right? I have the type, and then right after that, I have the curly braces. And the curly braces go all the way down to there. And hotels is a slice of hotel. So I'm going to have entries. So there's one entry, there's another entry, comma separated. So that's the first entry. And the first entry is a hotel. So I got to have a hotel, the type, and then the curly braces for composite literal, right? And then I have the fields and whatever they're set to. So when I run this, and we are at 14.01. I got those two. Kind of crappy named hotels. That bottom one. Close enough. So that's my first sort of take on it. And then my second take was to do the struct route. And I dropped region into the struct. Got region there twice. That's kind of funny. I might be cleaning this up. Region southern, region southern. So that's sort of redundant. Let's get rid of that one. Get rid of that one. Get rid of that one. So region and then the hotels. Region. Going to have two fields, region and hotels. Hotels is a slice of hotel. So a slice of hotel. Slice of hotel goes from there to there. And this one goes region, has this entry and that entry, just that. Just one region and two hotels.
So here you're more or less dividing the hotels based on their region.
Yeah, dividing the hotels based on the region. And I think in the third one, just make sure two works.
In your template, you have region taken out from the hotel part.
We'll see. Apparently had it okay in the template. Or it's fine ignoring it. Let's look. Region, hotels. Let's see what the third one looks like. So different regions. Hotel, region, has the hotels in that region, and then regions is just a whole bunch of slice of region. Different region.
Note that for your templates, you are not required to make that upper level slice as specific type. You can just pass in the slice directly without having it be a type.
Yeah.
But this makes it easier to look at and read. You can just say regions instead of having having an underlying type.
So regions is a slice of region. So here's where my slice starts. Goes all the way down. There's another entry in the slice, another region. Another region. And then each region has a region in the hotels. So the region is southern. And hotels is a slice of hotel. So there's my slice of hotel. When I run this one, southern, northern, central, same hotels in each region. That's because I didn't change them when I'm passing in. How many people have had enough of working with data structures? Nobody. How many people want more? Nobody. How many people just want me to like make the decisions for you? Yeah, a lot of hands, okay. So there's another one with restaurant, another one with restaurants, pretty similar. So you can look at those on your own. Okay? And this code is not right now on GitHub. So who's new to GitHub? I know that some people, when you first started this class, you're like, what's GitHub? I've never used GitHub. How do I use GitHub? Who is in that camp? All right, what do I do to push this code up? Newbies. Git add dot. I can do a git status. Well, that's been modified. Git add dash dash all also is sometimes to add stuff, and then git status. Now it's all green. Went from red to green. It's pretty cool. It's like Christmas. Huh?
Your file names are always so long.
It's because I wanted to be descriptive because they're for teaching. So people could find things. I could find things easily.
As I look at these JPEG names, which are random letters and numbers.
Yeah. I think that's when we were doing UUIDs.
Yeah.
So, or name and files.
Possibly. These look like hex values. But in any case, the reason why the dash dash all worked as opposed to the dot is that dot is current directory down, whereas the dash dash all is the entire repo, which it detected it was in a subfolder of a repo and went up and found everything.
Thank you. I didn't know that. And now git commit adds data structure challenges and solutions and git push. So it should be up there now. All right. Let's look at cross-site scripting. We already looked at that, right? We already looked at that.
Yeah,
and we looked at server, and we looked at file server, and then we had a challenge, and then solution, and Linux in class, and errata. What happened to my mucks? This is what we haven't seen. We haven't seen mucks. So what the way we've seen stuff so far here, we have handle func, and we just say the route and then the function, and a function needs a certain signature, needs that signature, those parameters. And here we have listen and serve, and listen and serve is the port, and then we're saying nil. So nil is default serve mux. And if we go over and we look at the documentation on that, listen and serve starts an HTTP server with a given address and handler. The handler is usually nil, which means to use default serve mux. Handle and handle func add handlers to default serve mux. Make that green. Highlight it. I like it. So here is nil, means use default serve mux. We can look for that on this page and see if we could read more about default serve mux. Mention there. Default serve mux is equal to a new serve mux. Default serve mux is the default serve mux used by serve. Interesting. Just kind of going for a little exposure, reading the docs, getting a different level of depth, right? Handle registers the handler for the given pattern in the default serve mux. Serve. Handler is typically nil, in which case the default serve mux is used. So what you're going to see, what I'm going to show you, is just like, hey, one little level deeper for understanding kind of what is a serve mux, default serve mux. We had this one right here, default serve mux equals new serve mux. What's new serve mux? New serve mux gives me a pointer to a serve mux. What's a serve mux? ServMux is a struct, contains filtered or unexported fields. It's an HTTP request multiplexer. Okay, it matches the URL of each incoming request against a list of registered patterns and calls the handler for the pattern that most closely matches the URL. So that's kind of what we've seen, right? request multiplexer, determining which request, what code runs based upon the request. This is a serve mux. Mux is for multiplexer. So we can read more about that there. But one of the things which is interesting is when we do the new serve mux, we get a pointer to a serve mux. And if we come up here and we look at the index, when we have a serve mux, so new serve mux gives us a pointer to a serve mux. When we have a serve mux, we have handle, handle func, handler, serve HTTP. So we have different methods attached to serve mux. Serve HTTP, what is ours using? Listen and serve. Let's listen and serve do. Address, handler, gives us back an error. Server, server, address handler, return server, listen and serve. It's kind of curious to dig around a little bit. So nil is the default serve mux. But we could also do stuff like this. We could say mux is equal to an HTTP new serve mux. And when we get a new serve mux, we have mux handle. So here's mux handle. And it takes a pattern and a handler. So there's the pattern. And there's the handler. Well, what's a handler? Takes a handler. A handler is an interface. How does something implement the handler interface? How does some type implement this interface? Yeah, by having this as a method. Right? So any type that has this as a method is a handler. Interesting. So we could come up here and we could create a cat handler or whatever you want to call it, make it an int. Who cares? Some type.
You could use an empty struct if you want.
You could use an empty struct. And then we could attach this method. That's the method right there. Serve HTTP response request, serve HTTP response writer and a pointer to a request. We could attach that method, and cat handler just became a handler. Just implemented the handler interface. So now, for our mux handle, because when we have a new serve mux, a new serve mux gives us a pointer to a mux. When we have a pointer to a mux, we have handle. So we created our own multiplexer here, HP new serve mux, and we called it mux. And now we have with new serve mux, we have a pointer to a serve mux. And with that pointer to a serve mux, we have handle. And handle takes a pattern and a handler. So here's the pattern. And the handler, we just created a handler. We created a custom type, and we attached this method to it. So that's the signature. I guess that's all the signature, but this is the receiver, right? And then this is the method that's needed to implement the handler interface. And so now, with cat, right, we could call cat, var cat, which is this type, and that's a handler. So when it comes here, it'll say, hey, I've got type cat, which is cat handler. Well, where's that method? It's right here. Okay, let me use it. And then it serves. How would you put that? You want to give it different verbiage, Daniel? Say that in a different way. Maybe hearing two different ways of describing it all will help it click for people.
No, I think you've got
it. Or Alan, or anyone else. Shin, Aaron, JJ, Jeevjot. So, yeah, go ahead.
These these sort of things are more of a just do it, fiddle with it, see what you can do, see what you can't do kind of things.
Yeah, and I just wanted you to sort of like, you know, if we didn't just use the default serve mux and just say nil, because before we're just saying nil, default serve mux. And then we have handle func, right? Just right at the package level up here. We have HTTP handle and handle func right at the package level. So handle registers the handle for the given pattern in the default serve mux. So when we're using default serve mux, we could just say HTTP handle. And again, when we're using default serve mux, we could say HTTP handle func. Well, how do we know we're using default serve mux? Well, when you pass in nil to listen and serve, you're using default serve mux. Well, what if I don't use default serve mux? What if I want a higher level of customization? What if I want to start tweaking things, whatever, on the multiplexer level, right? Okay, well, you could start making your own. And you just need some type which implements this method to be a handler. You create a new serve mux, gives you a pointer to serve mux. Pointer to serve mux, and then you have these methods attached to that that type, right? And you could do handle and handle func right there with these off of your pointer to serve mux. So I could say handle, and here's the handler. How many people that helped some things click about interfaces and reading the docs? Let me just see your hands. How many people you're working on other assignments?
Okay. One thing to note is that listen and serve, that second argument is a handler, just like the handle that thing. So you can actually put, we could put dog into listen and serve, or cat into listen and serve instead of mux if we wanted.
Cool. And then all it does is serve up dog.
Yeah, then it'll always serve up dog.
Dog's a handler.
So if you wanted, you could create your own serve mux as an alternative to the built-in one using this. So the built-in one is actually kind of slow. I personally prefer Julian Schmidt's third-party mux myself. So that, but it's not handle and handle func. It's not the only way of doing things. You can put whatever you can. Whatever multiplexer you want, that's so long as it fulfills that handle interface, that can go to listen and serve. And if it's got its own manner of then routing to your individual pages, it's all the better.
And if you're doing really creative things with your URL, the Julian Schmidt router makes it really, really easy to do so.
Yes, the Julian Schmidt router is good for RESTful APIs, which we'll get to eventually.
So if this is asking for listen and serve, is asking for a handler, what makes this pointer to a serve mux a handler? It's one of these four. How many people say it's the first one? You got to vote for one. So there's one, two, three, and four. If you didn't have laptops in your lap, I'd make you get up and go to one corner of the room. And take a stand. How many people vote for two? How many people vote for three? That makes it a handler. How many people vote for four? How many people are abstaining and not exercising your democratic responsibility?
I honestly just have no idea which one it is.
It's four. Because for something to implement the handler interface, it needs to have this method, right? And so the pointer to serve mux has that method. It's right there. And so that makes it a handler. It's implementing the handler interface. And since it's implementing the handler interface, we could pass it in to listen and serve. How many people are wondering just why the hell you studied computer science in the first place? Why am I studying this? The minutiae! I'm telling you, it's killing me! It's engineering. And engineering requires precision. And you have to, like, to the nanometer, be able to craft that gear to match another gear. Right? That's just watchmaking. It's programming. It's engineering. And there are times where I'm like, why? This is crazy. The detail. All right. So that's creating your own custom serve mux. And I thought that was just something too good to be aware of. I don't have the best examples worked out because I've been seriously ass kicked. And this code might shift because there's more stuff that illustrates what I'm going to show you, and so I might rearrange it all. But here, dog handler. Cool, I've created my own type, and I've attached this method. So when I attach that method, what does it make this type? This type is now implementing what interface? The handler interface, because it has this method attached to it. And so I have dog, and it's implementing the handler interface. I created my own multiplexer, so I now have a pointer to a serve mux. It's a pointer to a serve mux, has the method handle, which allows me to pass in a route, and then also say, what handler do I want to use? So anything coming in here, I'm using this handler. Dog is dog handler. Dog handler has that method, so when it goes here, it's going to run that code, right? That's what makes it a handler, and that's what it needs. So that's where I feel like maybe you could describe that a little bit better, Daniel. Like, basically, because it's a handler, because it has this, and when you go to this route, it says, oh, you know, variable dog type dog handler, I'm going to run this because you're asking for a handler, and that's what makes it a handler. That's my way of explaining it. That's yours too. I think I'm getting better. Daniel used to always have different opinions. He's like, no, that's good.
For this example, I will say you don't even need the mux. He's only got one route and it's going to everything. Might as well just stick dog in for the second argument and get rid of the mux entirely.
There you go. Like that. Yeah. But it's illustrative.
Yes.
And I've just kept one. So it's not cluttered. So have you guys seen this before? I think we looked at this already, correct? And we saw the ramifications of that. Response header set. How many people? That rings a bell. How many people know? Okay, cool. So this image right here, we've seen that. Looks like a pretty simple image. Something you want to burn into your head. Clients make requests. They're received at the server. Servers make responses. They go back to the client. The request and the response both have a request line, response line. The response line, sometimes referred to as the status line, right? And then they each also have a bunch of headers. And then they each, not depicted in this image, can also have payload or some sort of a body. So if this was a form that was being submitted, there would be, you know, information that's being transmitted. We know that, right? We kind of know this. Maybe we didn't know this about the request line and the headers and the response line and the headers, but we know, oh yeah, you're sending stuff over with the form and then you're getting stuff back, so the content. So that stuff right there, we're interested in the headers because the headers tell your browser what to do, and the headers also pass important information. And so if we go and we look at like header fields at Wikipedia, and I think I had another example that showed the status line. We can look that up in a second. Header fields are components of the header section of a request and response messages in the HTTP protocol. They define the operating parameters of an HTTP transaction. HTTP status line, HTTP response line. So status line, request line, that's what I want. HTTP response, what I get here, same deal, and HTTP request line. See what's here. So the request request line, general header, request header, entity header, carriage return line feed, carriage return line feed message body. Request line is equal to method space request URI space HTTP version carriage return line feed. So kind of precision again. Make that bigger. So that's the request line. This isn't ringing bells?
I think we covered this in this class.
We didn't? Okay. So that's the request line. And then we have the stats line or response line. Just looking at what my different choices are here. I've been here. Let's see what's on this page. I've even highlighted stuff here. Request line. So here's an example of the request line. You just saw that. So here's the method is get. And then the next one was request URI. Path to file index.html. Why is it called a URI, not a URL? What is a URL? What's URL stand for? Uniform Resource Locator. What's URI stand for? URL versus URI. What's the difference? I love you, Stack Overflow. A URL can further be described, URI can further be classified as a locator, a name, or both. The term uniform resource locator refers to the subset of URIs that, in addition to identifying resource, provide a means of locating the resource by describing its primary access mechanism. The uniform resource name. So all URLs are URIs. Actually, not quite. See below. Edit. I previously thought that all URLs are valid URIs, but as per comments, right, it gets a little bit tricky.
Again, Todd, I'm interviewing for Google. I don't believe I could remember that.
Oh, wow. Second post isn't outright blaming the person who asked the question. Did you really have to Stack Overflow?
Here, watch out for this cross-site scripting attack. Thanks.
So, URL to me means it includes HTTP, www, domain. URL, that's URL, and URI is to me just like the path. Maybe URL is HTTPS, www, and URI is the domain. Anyhow. Physical resource, locator name or both. Yeah, so I think that's the www. One can classify URIs as locators. Just give me an example. Okay, go ahead.
So URI is basically the name of a file or something. You go on like your file system, the particular file path would be a URI. A URL includes information like, how do you access this? So if it's on your file system, a URL would include file colon forward slash forward slash. If it's on the internet, it would be HTTP colon forward slash.
There we go.
So URI is just basically the name. Can possibly include information on how to find it, but generally if it's got the identifier for a specific something, that's URI. URL is that specific something plus how to get it.
Yeah, so URL is going to include HTTP or FTP because theoretically you could access the same information both ways. So that is the request URI. And then we have a space and we have HTTP version, HTTP 1.0. And then we have a carriage return line feed. That's the request line.
I think everything nowadays was HTTP 1.2 is the more common, or 1.1.
Yeah, 1.1.
Yeah.
And Go 1.6, I think, uses HTTP 2.
That'll be nice.
So. Let me see. Maybe three protocols response. So the status line for the response is HTTP version space status code space reason phrase and carriage return line feed. So that's the status line for the response. Quant, 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 quant. Request. So an example, HTTP 1.0, 200, okay.
Or the next example down.
HTTP version, space, status code, reason phrase. HTTP 1, 200, okay. HTTP 1, 404, not found. All right, so that's the response line. So that's the request line and the response line. And then we have headers. So we got the request line and response line. For headers, general format for headers is key value. Header fields are transmitted after the request or response line, which is the first line of a message. Header fields are colon separated name value pairs. Terminated by carriage return and line feed character. The end of the header section is indicated by an empty field resulting in the transmission of two consecutive CRLF pairs. And so we have request fields. Right, they are header fields, colon separated name value pairs. So here are the request fields, a name, and then an example value. So request field can include things like accept encoding. And we can say, hey, or the browser will automatically say, I accept gzip. And so that, go ahead.
By the way, the CRLF that he's been talking about, that's a new line. Or rather, it's the Windows equivalent of a new line, not the Mac or Linux. It's a Windows new line.
And then we have response fields. And response fields are like content type, right? So we can set the content type. So all of that, one big journey, so that here in our code, we can see here response header set. We're setting one of the key value pairs. Content type, and then here's the value. So the field, the name, field name, and then the value, text, HTML, car set, UTF-8. So watch what happens when I don't have this. I'm going to comment that out. And we are at 02702. So it got my my localhost document, my headers, and the content type text plain car set UTF-8, not text HTML. It's just text plain. Those are my response headers. Right? But now as a server, if I want to change that header, take this comment out. Kill the server, restart it, refresh, and I get a dog. And if I look at that file that came down, content type text HTML. Not before we had
text plain,
thank you. Right, now we have text HTML, so my browser says, oh, this is HTML. So instead of just showing an image tag, it's just text, plain text. Instead of just showing an image tag, I'll actually show that as HTML. text HTML. And you can see here, you know, general request URL, method, status code. So status code is part of the request line or the response line. Yeah, response, right? Everything's okay. What's the request method? Where's that? Is that the status line, request line, or the response line? The request is get. Request line HTTP. Method, request URL.
Method's right there at the bottom of the screen.
Method, get. And response on HTTP. No method in there, but status code's in there for all the different status codes. I'll show you Daniel's favorite. Hold on. What?
It's in the twos, I think.
What?
Two of it or something.
So that's a partial list. You can see a full list here. This is actually in the spec. Status teapot. That's kind of funny.
It's an old April Fool's Day joke. They never got around to removing from the official HTTP spec. So it's still, if you look in HTTP's official spec, it's still in there. It still exists.
What's the spelling error that's in here? It's like one R instead of two, right? Where's that spelling error one that's in the spec?
I don't remember.
Yeah, there's a spelling error somewhere in the spec. HTTP spec spelling error. Refer. So that's kind of cool.
Go will usually be able to figure out that content type pretty well. Like for images, it'll be able to figure out that it's an image, whether it's a JPEG or a PNG. For most HTML, it'll be able to figure out that it's HTML. The reason it didn't in this case is because the first line of HTML documents are supposed to start with the doc type line. And so this is not starting with the doc type line, so it just thinks it's plain text.
Yeah, so when you have doc type HTML, so it knows, based upon that, that this isn't text plain, this is text HTML. Content type.
So long as you are making your files correctly, you shouldn't have to manually set your content type. Usually, Go will be able to figure it out.
Bill Kennedy says he likes to have one level of depth greater than the level at which he's working. That way, if something stops working, he has a little bit of understanding of more depth of what's going on. And so that's kind of what you're getting here. That's a little bit of today. It's just like the detail. So one of the things which is interesting about this is how does that work? Response, header, set. So I want you to all find the documentation. We'll take 5 minutes to do this. I want you to all go in the documentation and look in the documentation and see if you could just sort of like breadcrumb trail, you know, through the different things, like where is res.header function.set, where is that? How's that working? Can you trace it in the documentation and read about it? So take 5 minutes and try to do that. Everybody understand? Where does RES come from? What is RES? Okay, it's a identifier. It's a variable of type HTTP response writer. Is that right? So what is HTTP? Where did I find that at godoc? What I type? What will I type in at godoc.org?
/net/response.
Yeah. So it comes from package net HTTP, right? So I go to godoc.org, net HTTP, and I'm looking for HTTP response writer. So that'd be like the first thing I can look for and just go straight to the index. And response writer, response writer, response writer, response writer. Oh, type response writer. Cool. And response writer is an interface. It's a type. So this is a res is a variable of type response writer. And it has a header, has the write method. I guess that's what makes it a writer, right? Because that means it's now implementing the writer interface. So anything that wants a writer, I could pass in a response writer. And I have write header. All right, so what's header? So I could click on header. Header is a map string, size string, represents the key value pairs in an HTTP header. Okay. And if I have a header, header type header, when I run this, I get that. If I have a header, I have these methods available. Let's search for header and just look at it in the index. Index type header. So when I have a header, I have add del get set write subset. So when we were just using a set, and a set asks for a key and a value, both strings. Set sets the header entries associated with key to the single element value. It replaces any existing values associated with the key. Cool. So we have response, and then a response is that type HTTP response writer. Right, and response writer has this method, which when run gives me a type header. So I run that, and I get a type header. And when I have a type header, I have these different methods associated with it, add, del, get, set. So I can do a set, and then it asks for key value pairs. And I can look up the list of different things to set right here. So one we just set was content type. And I could also see them here. There's content type. So I could start changing some of those response headers or adding in different ones. So we saw response writer, header, and header set. You have anything to add to that? Did I say that all correctly?
That's good.
I was just a little bit confused on the dun 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 dun. That's a method, right? You're calling a method, and it's returning that, right?
Yep.
I thought.
Response writer, they made response writer into an interface instead of a struct, because if you are writing unit tests, you can write your unit test to make your own thing that implements response writer, and then you can call your own code in a unit test to test if it's giving out the right information.
So what the response writer header set is basically doing is it's saying, all right, for this, what do you call it?
This response.
For that response, instead of doing whatever you were originally going to do, I want you to do this instead.
Yeah. Because originally it was reading this as text plain, because we didn't have that in there when we sent this back. Right? We just sent back this text. And the reason our browser couldn't figure it out, because our browser didn't have like an HTML document that declares doc type HTML. Oh, cool.
This is
I know
Go
what to do with this.
Actually.
Huh?
Go has got a few headers that it automatically sets. Content type is one of them. It's not the browser.
Oh, Go automatically sets that.
Yeah.
Well, I thought the browser saw Doctype and figured it out.
Nope, it's Go site.
Whoa, I didn't know that. That's
so
cool.
Yeah, there are a couple response headers that are required that Go will automatically set. Content type is one, content length is another, which that's a good one that you don't want to have to do yourself.
That's true, right? Because, I mean, that gets set, and where is it being set? It's doing it automatically. Did you dig that up in the docs to see in the standard, or in the code where it's actually doing it? You just sort of intuited it? Just logically makes sense.
Somewhat. I think it was in the docs somewhere. I think, or maybe Caleb mentioned it.
Caleb. Firehose. Firehose summer. All right. So that's just some interesting stuff. Response headers. And this entire image right there where we have a request line and headers and then some payload even if there's a form. And then response line and headers and content going back to the client. Being able to set headers.
Yeah, usually it's like that image shows and there's no payload when you're request.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's if you're like uploading, like if you filled out a form for like logging in or something, you'd have the payload, you'd have a payload in your request as well.
Cool. I just thought I screwed that up. Piso crapo. Rant. All right, so this is kind of fun. I want you to look in the documentation. Let's just do it together. So we could do request URL path. So we just did that thing where we looked up a response writer. Let's look up a request. Because then we're going to be able to do request URL path. And when we get that, I'll show you what it looks like when it runs. And for that, I need to be here, and I'm at 02, I need to go up 03, 01, pow, that's not very interesting. Pow. Oh, sorry. Piled high poop. Anybody ever ask you, should we build it in PHP? Piled high poop should be the first three words out of your mouth. You tell me. You looking for dung? So the request has stuff we could do with it too, HP request. So just Command F, request. And look at the index. Look for a big request over on the left. Type request. Sweet. And we could do a new request and get a pointer to a request in an error.
That's useful if you're going to make like a web browser or something and want to send a request out.
Yeah, like spoof a client. Mm-hmm. Make a request. And read request. Gives us sort of a pointer to a request in an error. And once we have a pointer to a request, we've got add cookie, basic auth, cookie, cookies, which is a slice of pointers to cookies, form file, form value, multi-part reader, parse form, parse multi-part form, post form value, proto at least, which returns a bool, referrer, which is a string, set basic auth, user agent, which is a string, write, which returns an error, and write proxy, which returns an error. I don't know what the hell all that stuff does. I know what some of it does. Just reading it makes me want to experiment with a lot of it and figure some of those other ones out. But here we add a piece of code that was request, which is a pointer to an HTTP request. Sweet, we got a pointer to an HTTP request. What is type request? Type request is a struct. So we have a pointer to an HTTP request. So not only are there all those methods we just looked at, but it's also a struct with all these fields. So when we have a pointer to a request, there's a URL field. There's the URL. And that's a pointer to from package URL, type URL. So we could go look at that. And type URL, net URL, right? Type URL has scheme, opaque, user, host, path, raw query, fragment. Ah, so request dot URL, that's one of the fields in the struct, which is request dot path. Sweet, path, right? And then path gave us back whatever the URI was, right, after localhost, the /forward.
It does not include the query or something, if you wanted to put that at show a query in the URL as well. It skips that.
Daniel has posted the challenge. I think it's localhost. This is go.
Two tabs over is the one that we had before.
Is it? Right there?
Yeah.
Oh, you're right. This is go, ? S equal 17. See you, Jose.
There you go.
Have a nice time at work. Could we get out that query? What would we use?
The raw query.
Yeah, well, raw query is looking pretty good. Let's try it. I want an AI version of Daniel running on my desktop at all times. That's a piece of software that will sell. And Alan, and Shin, and Aaron, and JJ. That's pretty cool. So we're able to get the request URL path.
And
go ahead.
What was why were we trying to also print out the S equals 17?
Just for hoots and hollers.
Yeah. We're just showing there's different parts of the URL and. That URL thing separates them out, so you can easily get to the different pieces.
Yeah.
So a lot of websites like Amazon, for example, will use the query part to show like where you got to this page from. Like if you on Amazon search for something, anything, and then you go click on something inside that search in the question mark, it'll show you what your search values were.
They sell everything. Nature's miracle. I don't think that's overinflated. To hell with the Grand Canyon. To hell with Hawaii. To hell with birds flying. Pooper scooper, picker upper. That's nature's miracle. So that's what we're looking at.
So yeah, keywords on the very far right of the URL box at the moment.
In fact, most search engines will have this kind of behavior because it's just easier for them to deal with it.
Yeah.
So we could pass data. Our data gets passed around in URLs. And everything after the question mark is some sort of data. So here's the variable, and here's the setting, the value. And then ampersand says, get ready for another one. And back in the day, see, here's the key words, dog plus poop. Back in the day, when people built websites badly, this was one of the places you could hack. Because some websites, you could literally just go in and start changing values and you get different stuff.
Todd, I'm sorry to break the mirror.
You still see websites like that today?
You still do. That's awesome. I do this all the time. I'll just switch a little bit of it around, see if it'll let me.
On some forums, you can make a little URL so when people click on it, they'll go and make a thread that you want them to.
Yep.
Merlot had that problem back in the day.
How could I do that? I'm not that often.
I got a problem I'm hoping you guys could help me with. Alan, Daniel. This one runs. Strings join. So here I'm just taking everything in the URL. I'm using from the strings package split and take my request URL path and split it up by those slashes. Because you remember I got all these slashes, right? So if I split this up, this should be value 0 right on the left side. That should be 1, 2, 3, index position. Okay, and then I could take those strings and I could just join them into a string. So take that slice of string and just join it into one string where you're separating each entry in the slice. And I could print out S. So that works. Let's check it out. And that is 02. Do you guys feel like I'm moving a little slow today? Yes, raise your hand. No, pace is just about right. Too fast. I kind of feel like I got that country rhythm. It's a feeling that only comes, like it changes the way you see the world and you move through the world. It only comes from having your ass seriously kicked. Like after you've been like seriously ass kicked for 2 weeks, it's like you just walk slower. You look at things differently. It's kind of cool. Like everything slows down, like this is what it'd be like if all you do is watch sheep all day, right? You're like a sheep herder country guy. You're just like, what's the rush? Where are you going, cowboy? Just slow. It's kind of a nice, peaceful feeling. But I imagine it could also be annoying if you're like, come on, pick up the pace. It's New York time. I've had people complain I talk too fast in my videos. I've also had people complain I talk too slow in my videos. I figure that must be about right then. All right. So let's split it up. Sweet. Right? This is go. Split it up. How many people are just like more and more impressed by Go? Like, this is pretty cool web stuff. Like, you don't need all that janky crap. It's all built for you, Ruby on Rails, and you just like sneeze on your keyboard and you have a website, but you don't really understand what's going on. It's like you take a couple minutes, you understand what's going on. It's like, sweet, look at all the functionality we have. Like we're building it all from straight up, you know? Sorry, I just got to brag about Go every now and then. Convince you we've made the right choice, I've made the right choice. So here's where I have the error in the code. 03, 03, 01. No, I need 01. See if you could help me solve it. 0, 1. 0 is nothing. 1 is this. 2 is. And then, you know, and in my code, I'm saying 1, 2. 1, 2, that's cool, that's what I wanted. But here, watch, it's totally gonna be working. Oh man, it blew up. And if I look at the blow up, index out of range, which means that when I'm trying to access something in my slice, right here, it's saying, eh, you can't access that. I don't have an item there. Well, it printed out all my items, so what blew it up? Let's troubleshoot. How would you troubleshoot this? Anybody got ideas? That's where you talk. Give me some ideas. How would you troubleshoot this?
I'd look at that error message and see what line it crashed on.
Okay, let's look at the... Ah! It's already gone. Main goes 16.
That's probably your where you're calling listen and serve. Yeah, that's your serve HTTP.
Index out of range. Main goes 16.
Yeah, go tracebacks are really painful because it's actually using multiprocessing, so it's got to throw out a traceback for every thread it's using.
Still cleaner than the error message for like a single-threaded C++ program.
It, with templates, yes. Yeah, it looks like it's crashing on line 16 all the time. Let's take a look at line 16.
But I have things in that position. How do we troubleshoot it?
Well, do you actually have things in that position?
Yeah, it's actually printing on the web page.
Printed it. Let's try this. So instead of having this go out to the browser, string split, let's just do it right at the terminal. Right? So when listen serve 8080 mux, when I go to / dog will run, when dog runs, it's going to take my request URL path, split it up, and then it's going to access 0 and 1 and print those to terminal. See if we get anything different at the terminal. Oh, I got to go run it. What's that tell you?
Well, I'm guessing the fav icon ICO is your F.
Let's look at version 1 again here. I appreciate you chiming in. That's awesome. And you're going down the right path. But I actually am not sure where this path ends because this is where my father-in-law came over with a box of oranges and a birthday card for me because my birthday's Friday. And so I was like, well, I'm done working. I didn't get to solve that. We'll solve it in class together. So when I run this, let's look at, I think I started already, yep. And let's look at this, developer's console, and make sure we're in network, and now reload it. And I'm getting fav icon. So it's asking for the document, and it's also asking for fav icon. These are fav icons. That little thing right there.
And if you ever go looking up the proper format for a fav icon, they get really complicated because...
Oh, dude, it's nuts.
There's no real official spec for them, so it gets really complicated.
And to make a beautiful fav icon is an art in and of itself. Because you have, like, 4 pixels to make that. I think it's, like, 16 by 16.
Something like that, yeah.
You know, so it's pretty amazing. I've spent literally many full days just reading and working on fav icons.
So it's trying to pull the fav icon, but you don't have it. Yeah, you don't have it.
Well, these are each requests. So run one request is go get this document. So it makes a request to there, right? And it goes and gets that, in which case I have that URL. But it also makes this request. So who's making that request? The client is, the browser is, automatically saying, do you have a fav icon so I can show it up on the tab? So Chrome is automatically asking my server for a fav icon. And my server says, what's the URL? Let's split it up and access things at the second position. There is no second position. There's position index position 0, which is right there between those two things. And there's index position 1. And there's no other / to give me position 2. So how do I work around that? If I just want to be able to grab things out of my deal and not have it also catch fav icon. Order what?
That it loads, so you can have it load the fav icon first and then the page second.
That's a good idea. How would we do that? So, first thing I thought was this little neat, nifty code, which just says, hey, you know what? If somebody asks for a fav icon, not found, baby. So if somebody, anything that comes in at this request, run that. That looks like it should do it. Because now, here at this one, that's when we're going to split things up. But if the fav icon request comes in, we don't have that, sorry. And so I'm going to give back that response from the server.
Huh. Article saying a raw path in URL.
Uh-huh.
We were looking at it earlier. Do you think you could use that? Would that, or would that still include the fav icon?
Raw path's the same as path, except I think raw path is the path exactly as typed into the URL box, whereas path will convert any escaped characters into their meant characters.
So this looks like totally promising. And I really like that solution. And I thought it was going to work. I call it fav icon be gone. Go run main. And just 8080. Didn't blow anything up there. Didn't blow anything up there. It does work. I don't know why I didn't think that worked. When I was running it at home, I guess I never got to the point where it was working. Sweet. So we totally solved it.
Although, why is it outputting fav icon ICO?
That's a good idea or a good question. So we are in O3.
That's right. Okay. Because if you format print line FS2, it should only be printing fav icon if it's.
Oh, so it's not working. Aaron, you're going to miss the drama, the end.
Yeah, it's in the helm.
Bleh. Did I start the server? Control C, it didn't even like it from the beginning. Index out of range. So why is that not working? Why is when fav icons ask for it? Seems like that's the problem, right? And do I have a big enough URL? No, I don't. Let me do the full URL. Ain't this something? River, hamburger, barbecue, wild free association. Control C, let's do it again, see what happens. Blows up again. Ain't this fav icon. Did I spell it correctly? Fav icon ICO? Isn't that what it's asking for? Fav icon ICO?
You're not using the default serve box in listening serve.
I got different serve muxes running. HP handle.
You deleted the dog. You just pull dog back in. Our dog, Snoop, in main.
Perfect. 404, not found.
So now it works.
It worked. And we can play around with those different fields. You're like, what's raw path? So we got 0, 1, and 2, so that's why I printed out. But we could also just do format print line request URL dot path raw path request URI. I don't know what that gives me. Can I do that there? Does it give back a string? Gives back a string. We'll do that and see what happens. Interesting, just look at the stuff that comes back.
Yep. Yeah, because we fixed the error with when we changed. What it was he had that not found handler, but he was using http.handle, which is the default servmux, but he was passing in a non-default servmux, this be to listen and serve, and so it wasn't actually getting to that spot. That was attached to a different servmux. So we fixed main, so now it's not it's using the default servmux for dog and favicon, and it's going to nil.
Yeah, I got rid of the custom servmux. We went with default servmux. Pretty much just use default servmux. Nil. Right? And in a couple of weeks, we'll get to where we use Julian Schmidt's router, which gives us a little bit more power and functionality and actually is a little bit more performant than what's in the standard library. And I think when we do that, we put something else here, right?
Yeah, well, Julian Schmidt's creates his own mux.
So he creates his own mux and has different functionality, and then we say use this one.
If you ever go diving into servmux, though, this request.url.path is how it's working. It's just doing request.url.path, and it's just searching. You use handle function to register URL paths, and it just and then it listen and serves passes in everything, and it just says, okay, this your request.url.path is this one. It goes to this function. Called and then pass it on, pass request and response writer onto that function. So that's how you'd make your own if you wanted to. You could make your own mux. You just have it separate based off of the request path. You shouldn't need to though. There's plenty out there already pre-made.
Is this where we found the solution? No, that's not it. It's node 3. I guess just, I don't know, you guys want a little exercise? I feel like I've been talking for about 900 minutes.
It's only been 90.
Multiplied by 10, 78. Got about 20 minutes left. How do you guys want to spend the time? Quit asking us and just tell us what to do.
Well, what sort of exercises do you have in mind?
I don't know. Let's get your hands working again. So let's do the data structure for this one. So create the data structure to hold menu information. My son woke up this morning. He's like, I want to go to the sausage store. What's the sausage store? Let's go to the sausage store. It's like, oh, about 6 months ago, we ate breakfast at Huckleberry's. You guys ever eaten at Huckleberry's? It's actually pretty nice. Right at Champlain and Perrin. We went there this morning, 7:30.
Could have said anything else at
eggs, pancakes, no, sausage.
Yeah, I know, it's kind of cool. The sausage store. All right, so create this DAO structure. You got 5 minutes. How would you capture menu information to pass into a template? And I just drill this because I think it's a, for me it was a hurdle, figuring out how do I get all my data into the right structure to pass into the template. I brought in a cuties or whatever they are. Pass them around. Take as many as you want. Because, like I said, my father-in-law brought me a big box of oranges from his tree. I love the oranges from his tree, so it's like we aren't going to get through those now. So I figure I'd give them away while they're fresh. We just got them a couple of days ago at Costco. So DAO structure, 4 to the restaurant, version 1, item on a menu could have name, description, and then what meal it's for, breakfast, lunch, or dinner, and then it could have a price, and then just give me a slice of those. And there I have all the items randomly for a menu. That's solution number 1. You want to see that a little longer?
Yes, please.
I realized since I closed that was kind of quick. Another, you, anybody need another minute, or is it good? Another minute? I see some people still typing. Let me know if you need another minute. Otherwise, I'm going to move on. They're just typing. It looks like they need another minute. I'll give them another minute. Good? Here we go. Moving on. Didn't get all XCMF class. And then my second solution was like that. So item has name and description and price. And then a meal will have what meal, breakfast, lunch, or dinner, and it'll have a slice of items. And then a menu will be made up of a slice of meal. So different menus for different restaurants. No, this is one restaurant. A menu will have a slice of meal, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. It's good. Anybody need another moment? Say, I need another moment. Okay. Another moment. How many people are intrigued by building a website? Like, I want to be able to do that. Build a really nice, data-driven, good-looking website that offers something to the world. Definitely draws me too. How many people like web versus app better? In terms of like, you know, you'd rather start an app or you'd rather start a website?
If I had to choose between the two, I'd go web.
You'd go web?
I'd prefer not to.
Apps are kind of like...
I think both are necessary.
Both are necessary.
Of course, but apps, you really just want to learn one, you use Ionic.
Apps are like, people have 20 apps they use. If. 5 to 12 apps. An app is kind of like asking somebody to come to your house for dinner. You know? You're opening the door, you're putting it on your machine. A website's like meeting somebody on the bus. Meet all kinds of people on the bus, whatever. They're not coming home with you.
It's kind of ironic considering it's actually slightly easier to make a website that infects someone's computer than it is to make an app that can, onto the app store that can infect someone.
Yeah.
They'd call it a memory leak.
This course came out.
Is it finally?
Code Clinic for Go. Came out yesterday.
Finally.
.go.
Apparently their site sucks. LinkedIn bought it, so it's all downhill. And, I look tired. I'm not looking so good there. There's one of my friends, Zeno Roca, says, right? Your comfort zone, where the magic happens. When you get outside your comfort zone, that's where the magic happens. But that's also where you hit the wall at 200 miles an hour. Because when I did this, I was definitely outside my comfort zone. I was outside my comfort zone technically, so I was stretching so hard to be able to accomplish what they were asking me to accomplish, asking to have done. I had to draw on the help of a lot of friends, including the guys in this room, to get some of the challenges done. And then also, I was outside my comfort zone just in terms of a work environment. It's one thing when I'm at home and I make videos and it's like 2 in the morning and I'm in my pantry and it's like, I don't care if you watch this. That's like my shtick or whatever. I'm comfortable. And if I don't like it, I just record it again. It's another thing when you go in and you're in a recording booth and they have a whole system and they have a team of people standing behind a glass wall on the other side saying, okay, your sound levels are good. Go ahead. It's like, the fuck, I'm flying the space shuttle. I've got NASA Mission Control listening to every mistake I make as I code and go. So I was out of my comfort zone in terms of my work environment. I was out of my comfort zone in terms of my technical environment. I give myself a low B on this. But you know what? That's where the magic happens. I grew. And in growing, progress doesn't happen without... progress doesn't happen without casualties, right? So one of the casualties is the product's not as good as it would have been if I hadn't gotten so far out. That's one of the casualties. Another one of the casualties is like I didn't come off looking quite as well as I would have been if I was more in my comfort zone. But I grew because I drove a Formula One race car. It's like, whoa, now I know what it feels like to do 200 miles an hour around the track, right? To be in a more high-end production zone, production development environment, to really stretch myself in terms of code. Yeah, that's my disclaimer for these videos, but also kind of cool. It's up there. And there's some really cool stuff in here. There's some that are really great. Like I felt super comfortable here. I felt, pretty comfortable there and super comfortable building the web. Like I hadn't even done these two problems until I went down there. And then it was like Wednesday night. I'm like, crap, I got to do these so I can record them tomorrow. But this one right here, accessing peripherals, man, that sucked. Eight queens, that was all Daniel. That's like all Daniel code right there, eight queens. Daniel figured that one out. Image analysis, that was like 2 months to do image analysis. Pixel by pixel, comparing images for matches. And take the top left pixel of the needle image, try to find it in the bigger image, the haystack, compare it to every pixel, make like 90 million comparisons in 3 minutes. And when you get a match, so the difference between RGBA is within some threshold, start comparing in a sequence across. Great, you got that figured out. Now do it in case the image has been rotated. And just reverse all of the logic. Now run all that concurrently. Whoa, that was like 2 months figuring that out. But it's like, I'm proud of that. You know, like I got that working with the help of some of my friends.
If you look at some of the other projects for other programming languages, not every one of them actually did it. I know, like, the JavaScript person in JavaScript didn't actually do it. He just kind of said, if you're running this in JavaScript or web browser, you're going to have a server that's doing this for you. Here's how you call the server.
I wasn't sure that they would leave this in the course, but I just put it in, figuring what the hell. Because there's this concept to the Lakota Sioux Indians called Metaquie o Yasin. And the idea behind the concept is that all of your relatives are the ones who are standing behind you, all of your relations. They're the ones who helped you get to where you are. So the Indians believe when you go into battle, it's like you, but you have all your ancestors right behind you, your whole generation. And so it's only with the help of these people, Bill Kennedy, Caleb Doxey, Daniel Hoffman, Corey Deal, Ray Villalobos, and Zena Roca. It was only the help of those individuals, plus many others, that I got to where I am with programming. There you go, Daniel. You're on lynda.com, man. So I'll see you guys next week. Watch, I might put up a homework assignment. Does anybody have any questions? How many people got their money's worth today? How many people want a refund? Those guys already left.